Welcome everyone to this first morning session. Today we're going to talk about Millennium Youth and how young people can engage in the Universal Sustainable Development Agenda 2015 and 2030. Before presenting you the guest that we have today with us, I'd like first to introduce a bit the topic. So we've heard from the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon that young people will be the torchbearers of the post-2015 agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals, with a critical role in ending poverty, inequality, hunger, and environmental degradation. Yet, young people have been and still are disproportionately affected by economic crisis and recession in Europe and around the world. Young people will be crucial to drive the agenda forward, yet they're underrepresented within the proposed goal and target in the post-2015 agenda. So this session will be about trying to bridge the gap between what we would like to see in terms of young people participation and the reality of the situation in the world. I'm Bérénice Jean, I'm a board member of the European Youth Forum, and I will be moderating this session. I would like first to present you the speakers that we have today with us. I'm really thankful for them joining us in this session. So first of all, we have Madame Laimdota Straujuma, Prime Minister of the Republic of Latvia. Thank you for joining us. We have as well with us Ahmed Alendawi, UN Secretary General's Envoy for Youth. Thank you as well for being with us. And last but not least, Mrs. Linda McEwan, Chair of the Development Committee for the European Parliament. So this is one part of the speakers that we will have today, and later on we will have young people joining us from the Millennium Youth Project. So they've been working to prepare for this session for quite some time now, and I will call them as they will move to the stage, because they cannot be all them at the same time on the stage. And they will introduce themselves when they come up. As you have noticed, we have speakers from very different backgrounds, representing different levels, from the national level to the EU level and the global level. This is connected with the nature of the new Sustainable Development Framework, which aims to be a universal agenda that will impact all countries and regions, including Europe. All goals in themes in the agenda are necessary and important, and they're all interrelated as well, but some aspects were identified by the young people participated in the preparatory workshop as the issues they would like to bring forward here today. So maybe to explain you a bit how this will work out. So we will have three different sessions articulated around different topics. The first one will be about social inclusion, and more specifically gender equality, employment and poverty. The second one will be about quality education, and the third one will be about the well-being of people and the planet. So in considering all of these topics, we'll be focusing on how the post-2015 development agenda is of importance for young people all around the world, and how they can be involved in implementation and making sure the goals are achieved once they are finally agreed upon in September. Just a quick heads up for the audience, if you want to get involved, there will be several ways. After a short video that we will look, there will be a Twitter wall, so don't hesitate to get involved there. You can use two hashtags. The first one is EDD15, and the second one is SDG Youth. And I'll try to make it as participatory as possible. Okay, so first of all, we will start with a video. So The video that we want to show you is presenting the opinions and messages of young people that have been participating in an international workshop organized in Innsbruck by SOS Children's Village Austria and the International Office in March 2015. The workshop included thematic discussion on children's rights, global development, and inequalities.
Kids realize that when they say important stuff, adults don't really care.
In our country, people who live in care, they are called orphans all the time. But this is something that we don't like, orphans all the time.
They kind of push you away. Not everybody.
Discriminate.
They discriminate, you know.
We are from different countries, but we have the same heart and we can think the same, but another language, you know, that's the only difference we have.
I have to read 4 or 5 different articles about the subject to make my own opinion about it.
Da gibt's noch mehr Jugendliche, die sich beteiligen wollen.
If I was a wizard, I would take all the brains in the world and make them unable to see things like skin color, sex, religion. I would make all the things people judge all the time invisible.
The other countries have that opportunity, the governments to help them with money, but in our country, this does not exist. In Albania, we have just to fight for these things. We need in the same time to go to school, to work, to survive.
Our politicians don't want the word love to be in the law about children in Norway.
They say that you can't say to someone that you have to give love because it's such a personal feeling. But now the entire child protection law is going to be changed and we're writing the first draft.
You could have all the other things and it still wouldn't be enough if you didn't have love there. I think people need to be brave enough to dare to get attached and to dare to give love to people who maybe it doesn't look like they deserve it. Maybe people who are angry or destructive or just wants to go away, and we have to prove to them that they're worth something.
I want to see a Europe where all young people get involved in changing it and make it better.
Where all young people have the opportunity to take action.
Have the possibility to be listened, respect and protect. Where it is important to be honest with us because we are the future.
It's just with the truth who you can improve, you know, and move on.
You see this and you know there are like 7 countries and there are a lot more who are not here. And then you're like, look, we're not alone. The whole country and the whole world is full of people like us and we can make a change together in every country and in the whole world.
Okay, so while I'm calling to the stage the young people participating in the first discussion, so we have Noor Nahas, Migena Jaferai, and Maru Balimbali. I would ask you, so I don't know if you follow up, but there is an app for the EDDs that allows you to participate a bit. And I would like, at the beginning of each session, to ask you one question. And basically, it will be a statement that you will say, OK, I agree or I disagree with this statement. And that I will ask our speakers to have this in mind while the discussion happens. So I would like you to take your app, if you have already it. It was sent to you before the event. And maybe we can have it on the screen as well. So when you go to the app, you have a voting part. So when you click on it, you have to choose the room that you are in. So it's A3. And then you will have the voting possibilities that we will display on the screen as well for you to know what the number corresponds to. So the first question that I would like to put forward is this one. Do you agree with this statement? In spite of the world's diversity, a universal post-2015 agenda will encourage all countries, including European ones, to commit within their own borders. So do you agree or disagree at different levels? And the voting starts now. Sure. If you have it. Let's see if it works. Okay, so I don't know if everybody could participate. Some of you, I guess. Okay, so we will do that at each session. So it's quite interesting to see that there is more or less an agreement with that. So I hope we can have some interesting discussion and feedback on that as well. So I would like first to invite Noor Nahas, Migena Jaferai, and Maruba Limbali to give us their statement. So we will start with Noor, please. I think it's working.
Hello, everyone. My name is Noor. I'm 16. I'm from Lebanon, and I'm a board member of the Children's Council, a program created by World Vision Lebanon. I'm here today to represent Lebanon and the Middle East and to talk about the fifth Sustainable Development Goal, which is gender equality. And I'd like to address my question to Mr. Ahmed Al-Hindawi, because he's the person who can relate the most to what I'm about to say. So as you all know, Lebanon is an Arab country, and Arab societies are mostly patriarchal societies. So females face a lot of problems and issues in all the Arab countries and worldwide. So I highlighted the five main issues, which are nationality and family name, early marriage, divorce, domestic violence, and participation of females in politics in Lebanon. So I'm going to start with the nationality and family name. Lebanese and Arab women are not allowed to give their nationality and family name to their kids. So their kids only take their dad's nationality and family name. And I kind of think that it's not fair or it's not logical to prevent someone to give their nationality to their kids based on their gender. And the second issue is early marriage. In the Convention of Children's Rights made by the UN, early marriage is forbidden. Yet many girls, especially in the Arab world and Lebanon, are forced by their parents to leave their schools and get married at an early age like 12 or 13. And I see this on a daily basis in my society, because I know many of my friends got forced to get married at an early age. So the third issue is divorce and the way society looks at a divorced woman. Divorced women are rejected and refused by the society in our countries, unlike men. So because society thinks that it's their fault because they couldn't make their family or husband happy, so that's why they got divorced. But we all know that if a couple fails, both a man and woman are responsible for the failure of their relationship. So we can't just judge women by their marital status. It might not be their fault. They might be violated, or which is the fourth issue is domestic violence, which is a main issue worldwide and in the Arab world, because it's a taboo topic we can do nothing about it in Lebanon and the Arab world, because violated women sometimes go to organizations to seek for help, but they can't always find the help they need. So, and the last issue I'm going to talk about is the parliament in Lebanon. It's really funny because only 4 members of parliament out of 128 are females, and we have no female ministries. So my question to you, Mr. Ahmed, is what can the UN do to encourage the gender equality in Lebanon and Middle East and empower females to be equal as men?
Take all the statements and questions from young people, and then you can answer and maybe add inputs on the other topics as well, if it's okay with you. Thank you. So then it will be Megena, please.
So, hi. Mr. Ahmed Alhandavi, Ms. Linda McGovern, and Mrs. Lindwota Straujuma. And dear ladies and dear gentlemen, which are all present here today, I want to thank you for being here and for providing me some minutes of your time. I am Igena Jaferai. I am 20 years old. I come from Albania, as well as children's villages. And I am here to represent the Millennium Youth of my generation, also young people of my country, and young people who live care. Today with you, I will focus my speech on a very important topic, but not the only one, a decent work for all, which is the 8th goal of the Sustainable Development Goals, and shortly named as SDGs, as you know. My view on this topic, it is going to be in two main point of views, you know. The first one is parental unemployment, and the second one is young people unemployment, and we are going to see that both of these point of views are very related to each other and linked. So, I actually wanted to say that in my country, parental unemployment is in a very high level. Because of parent unemployment, I mean, because of this situation, children have the very high risk of facing the losing of their parental care. As parents find themselves very unable to provide for their families, they may be forced to migrate and to leave children behind. They also seek for alternative care arrangements for their children in the hope that their situation will be much better and they will live a better life. So this is the situation in my country of parental unemployment, but from the other side, we have youth unemployment, which actually is seen that young people are more likely than adults to be unemployed, underemployed, or to work in informal jobs. This kind of working, it actually puts them in a very high risk of earning lower wages, of working in unsafe conditions without insurances, of working only temporary and not a decent job, of having very few or no prospects at all for advancements. Also, young people who leave care, they are simply not competitive to the job market at all. They find themselves sometimes forced to accept illegal work within minimal and irregular payment. Also, they have little or no access at all to health and social support. So these are the two views that I have actually wanted to share with you. And I would kindly ask to you, Mr. Alhandavi and Ms. Linda, two questions that you may help with some answers. So my first question is, how will this SDG, so this eighth goal, will particularly cover groups at risk, such as young people which leave care, and families that are at risk of separating their families because of not having a good, not having the possibility to work, to have a decent job. So I want to know, how can you cover this kind of target group? And my second question as well to you would be about monitoration of the indicators that we would like you to be defined. Maybe putting some indicators will, and also helping us to monitor it, may be a very good solution for us to not only participate in the beginning and in the end of these SDGs, but also during the millennium. I don't know if you have any specific plan for the setting of their of the indicators and for the monitoration process, but if yes, we would like to know if how can we be involved in this kind of process. So thank you all for your time, and I'm very open for your questions as well.
Thank you, Migena. And now I would go to Maruba, please.
Hello. Hello, everyone. My name is Maruba Limbali. I'm 14 years old, and I live in Zambia. I'm a youth delegate, and I represent children for my country and my society. I'm going to talk about poverty, which is the first goal in the Sustainable Development Goals. I'm going to talk about how we can reduce poverty through social accountability tools like citizen voice and action. Citizen voice and action is a method for local advocacy that helps to transform the dialogue between communities and their government. This can take place both at local level and national level. Poverty levels in my country and in Africa in general are very high. To help reduce poverty, decision makers should listen to the points of view of people who are in poverty. And they should take into account what people propose. For instance, to improve the quality of services in education or in healthcare and so on. People should be able to monitor that governments and authorities are doing to fulfill their communities and hold them to account if they fail to do as they promised. For my generation, extreme poverty will be reduced if we have better access to quality education and medical care through good schools and hospitals. Even though we are children, we have the right to participate in decision-making processes that have an impact on us. So my question is for Mr. Ahmed. My question for you is, what do you think can be done to make sure children's voices are heard and taken into account to improve quality services and thereby reduce poverty? Thank you, and feel free for questions.
Okay, well, thank you very much for the three of you. And now I would ask, well, Ahmed, if you want to start, since you have been the one asked a lot of questions.
Fortunate
and then
in the first round.
We will enter the discussion. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Prime Minister, it's a great honor to share this panel with you, Mr. Chair, head of the Parliamentary Committee, and I would like first to begin by thanking World Vision, SOAS, and indeed the European Youth Forum, and to all of you. The UN is an ally and a natural partner to the EU and the European institutions at large, and all what they do to spread development and to align their work with hopefully the new development agenda. And that spirit, I'm really honored to be here. Well, and thank you very much for the young people and my friends who I met this morning for breakfast or briefly interacted with. And allow me to start with you, Noor, and to say, as a person coming from the region, I'm your neighbor as well, from Jordan, if all our young women and young girls will be in the same spirit, I'm very optimistic about the future of our region. So keep up this spirit. And it will be a very easy answer for me to tell you I agree that we need to reverse all the points you mentioned, the 5 points. First, the political and civic participation for women should be well represented in mainstream societies. What we have today is a complex, I would say, challenges facing women and facing young women in particular. Globally, less than 6% of all parliamentarians around the world under 30 years old. And that's a situation also for young men and young women. But young women, they even face much more difficulties in accessing politics or obtaining their civic rights. And I think these numbers, they should be reversed. If we talk about half of the world's population under 25 years of age, and that to your question, is a question of legitimacy. If in any democracy, the majority would decide who would be the governor, who would be ruling the country. And if we have a world today where half of the world's population under 25 years of age, and we are not consulting them, or we still that consulting them is just like out of luxury or a box that we need to take, then we are in a big trouble. And what we're trying to reverse here and with the SDGs is to start with a global consultation. You mentioned the MDGs are 8 goals. I personally always call the MDGs are 9 goals, actually. There's goal number 9. For me, it was very successful. That's the goal to build a global awareness about the need for having global development agenda. In the first early days of the MDGs, after 2000, it took 4 to 5 years for people really to digest what's the idea of having global development agenda. Now, 4 years before, everyone is debating what will be the next generation of development agenda. That's a big success. Out of the 7 million who voted in my ward, 70% were young people and under the age of 30. So it's clearly that we have a big success with the MDGs in the sense of developing global awareness that is led by young people. So we have to make sure that we don't fail young people in the decision-making processes and taking this work forward. What the United Nations is doing with gender empowerment and women empowerment, I think with women empowerment, clearly we have Beijing, the most important guiding and I would say landmark document that is steering all the global efforts to fight all sorts of discriminations against women. But after 20 years of Beijing, we have, I would say, made important progress. But not even one country in the world, they have full equality between men and women. And we still have to do more there. Even after 20 years, I think the message of the United Nations, that it's time really to reverse that and to ensure the full participation of women. For me, women's empowerment is about the community empowerment. It's about the society empowerment. You can't really have empowered societies without the full participation of women. This might sound simple to all of you. But it's a simple math. Girls' education, women empowerment will really boost economies. It's a human right. It's the right thing to do. It's the morally the right thing to do. But also, pragmatically, it's very much the right investment to make in any society. Full empowerment and support for women. And the United Nations is starting at home. You know, the Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, who was in Brussels a few days ago, I'm sure many of you get the chance to meet with him, he appointed more women in senior position than what happened in the past 60 years in the organization. So even the United Nations were making important progress there, but that need also to be mirrored by and echoed by all governments around the world. And again, I think the participation of women, the participation of young people should not be seen as this is just a box that you take when you form a government, but comes really genuinely that you really want to have full engagement and full participation of women. With the question of decent jobs, and we have a big problem in our world today. I think even when we talk about a problem in Europe, so you can imagine how the situation will be in other parts of the world, that's the situation of youth unemployment. Youth unemployment is a serious crisis. 74 million young persons today are unemployed. And the projections to the future, we need 600 million jobs in the next 10 years. And maybe we could get another round of talk about some ideas for how we could reverse that and create more jobs for young people. But another very important point here that I want to respond to is the question of indicators and how we're planning to measure. Yesterday was the first meeting for the expert meeting and interagency that is discussing the indicators for the Sustainable Development Goals. And for me, the idea here is very simple. You should measure what you treasure, right? If we really care about youth participation, youth development, we should have all the right indicators in the new development agenda to measure that. Now, I'm concerned, to be honest, that even with the current negotiations, we are still missing some important targets and indicators. And for me, I can't really think of development for the next 15 years without making sure that I have all the indicators that we need there to measure youth development in all aspects. Political participation, jobs, education, non-formal education included, of course, health-related targets and the question of peaceful and inclusive societies. And we are still calling for more indicators. The process just started at the indicators level, and I really hope that we can make a progress here. And here you have a job to do, we have a job to do, everybody in this room has something to do about these indicators. These are not a technical conversation. You really need to lobby to ensure that the indicators we are calling for are reflected in the new development agenda. At the end, it's not really about the commitment or the political commitment only, but it's really about the indicators that we will need to measure over the next 15 years, and that's a very important point. I think, just back to you again, I think what you said, how to engage children in the and make sure that their voice is heard. I think the $1.8 billion question, because that's the number of children and youth today, will be how to modernize the tool we engage with young people and how to get organizations, institutions, and governments interacting with young people and children in different ways. I remember one day, and I'm going to conclude with that, I remember one day I came to Brussels here for an event at the European Parliament with the European Youth Forum, and it was a rainy day. So we were expecting maybe 200, only 50 people showed up at that event. But that was okay. And the same day, the Minister of Youth here, she invited me to go with her to Color Cafes, like this Color Festival here. I'm sure you are familiar with that. And I found like maybe 60,000 people in the rain dancing all night there. So what I'm saying here, you should not expect all young people to come to conference rooms. I think we really need to find different ways of engaging young people in the way we do development and the way we engage them in democracies and the way we engage them in governments. Young people today, they come to a point where they are interested in politics, but they are not interested in governments because they think governments is too analog for them and they just interact in a digital way. And I think the challenge here, not to blame young people, but rather to find ways to modernize what we're offering to them and engaging new tools and listening before designing is key to that.
Maybe you can react as well on the topic that were raised by the young people, but I would like maybe to ask one question that would be interesting to have here answered. Is basically how will the EU and its member states ensure that the rhetoric of the agenda within regions such as Europe goes beyond development cooperation and include at-home policies, that would say, like policies within their borders. So how, what is your role as well within the development agenda and in terms of the topic that were raised? Maybe to wrap up.
Dear friends, it is my honor to be with you, and it is really very interesting for me because it is not usual for me to participate in discussion with young people. And I'm happy to see here young people from Latvia. So I want to, all three young persons here and to all young persons in hall, I want to mention two key words. It's education and participation. Education is basis for all. And if we speak about Latvia, we really don't see any difference between a man or woman. And I personally, I am first prime minister woman in Latvia, but anyway, it is possible in Latvia to become everybody to prime minister if he will want very, very, very hard. And if he or she will have education, And I have 2 children. I have 6 grandchildren. And I am divorced. And it is, I'm same member of society as Olga, for example, who is here, young person. And I believe that you don't feel difference between in your school or high school, difference in attitude if you are girl or boy. Is it so? Yeah. And in Latvia, we have 60%, 60% from all higher education, people with higher education, 60% are women. And it is very good. And 40% from all heads of enterprises, 40% are women. That means that we have nearly same attitude, man, woman. So, but I am really very glad to see here all of you because participation is another point. If everybody of you, young ladies and boys, if you will not wait that somebody will come and propose you what to do, you have to decide yourself, you, your future. You from each countries, and if you will have coordination between different countries, if you will exchange your knowledges, and if you will decisive that we will see better future for our planet. Nobody will come. Only we. I, you, Olga, other persons, we are you. We are responsible for what we are doing. And education is another. Education, understanding that all we are equal. People with special needs, people from different nationalities, people with different possibilities. But I believe that each boy or each girl have to be possibilities to become prime minister. It depends so from all of us, from each personally. Thank you.
Thank you.
And maybe I will tell that we have in Latvia a program about youth employment, an employment program for Latvia, 40 million. It's not so small money, 40 million, what we propose for young people who have no job. They can choose to continue education or to have jobs in different enterprises. And now now I forgot, but a lot of young persons today have possibility to use this program.
Thank you very much. Thank you. You can applaud, yeah. I will have to be a bit of a timekeeper here because we have 2 other sessions to go to. So maybe small remarks from your side. Yeah, please.
Yeah, it's on, isn't it? So I'm Linda McAvan. I'm from the United Kingdom. So I'm the very lucky speaking my own language and impressed by all those who can speak my language so beautifully. I live in Sheffield in the north of England, which is a big city known for its steel and cutlery, knives and forks throughout many countries. And I'm a member of the European Parliament here, which means I come here to work Monday to Thursday, then go home to my constituency. And I do meet young people and listen, and we have school parliaments and youth organizations. And what strikes me is what the young woman at the start said, which is, although our lives are very different, they're also the same. The concerns are the same, but the problems in each country are different, and different degrees of problems. To Noor, I think you're right to focus on gender and equality, because if you have gender equality, these other problems start to disappear. We have not, of course, no country is perfect, but you mentioned, for example, about the children, the father's nationality and family names. Looking at Belgian people here, I have a friend, and she was a Belgian woman, married an Italian. And until not long ago, when she married an Italian, she lost her nationality as a Belgian. And when she divorced, she had to ask for her nationality back. Now, the law in Belgium has changed, but it's not so long ago. Most children in our countries take their father's name. That's the norm. You can take your mother's name, but it's still not the norm. So it's not like... and some now take both names, and it's a bit complicated. And domestic violence. My grandmother used to say to me, a good husband is a man who doesn't hit you. And that was her view, because that was her life. And life was tough. But things changed because we got equal rights for women. And as we got equal rights for women, these things became unacceptable. And we got more equality. And the other great truth is, when you have more equality, it's a better life for men and for women. It's not good for young men to be married to girls who are 13, 14. This is not a good marriage. It's not an equal marriage if you're much older. So it's better for everybody, and that's what we have to work for. And you have to fight for rights. That's the other great thing. You have to fight for them. You have to fight. You're fighting. I can see that. And you need more women and men to fight with you, because it's better for everybody. And I think you will get the change. I think you are part of the change. You're here today, and that's part of a change. To Miguela from Albania about, I said that problems are similar. Youth unemployment, big problem in all countries. But what we don't have as much inside the EU is the problem of parents having to leave their children behind. Maybe. But in my country, we don't have parents leaving children. And that's about poverty. And that brings me to the last point that Marubu raised about poverty. If you are poor, you have no choice. You know, I went to Congo, to DRC Congo, and I met children there, young people there with UNICEF. They have no choice because their lives are so hard. They're struggling even to eat. And then you have no real choice in life. And so resolving poverty is one of the biggest issues. And to do that, and to all of you in your own countries, you have to fight as well politically. You have to fight to make sure that those who can pay, pay. Those who have money must pay taxes. Only if they pay taxes and they pay in can you build schools and roads and education. That's part of a decent society. People who have money must pay. There must be more equality. We have to give support. The richer countries should support as well. And education is key. It's key to leaving poverty. You're absolutely right, Maruba. It changes lives. It changes societies. And the more people in education, the more we will see development.
Well, thank you very much. And it's a very nice transition to our next topic, which is going to be about education. We will try to have some kind of discussion as well with the room at the end of the three sessions to come back to what was said, maybe in terms of more transversal approach than topic approach that we have currently here. So we'll give a round of applause to our young people that were there bringing their inputs. And I would like to call to the stage Ralf Greenwald, Edgar Skozulinj, Stephen Reed, and Marita Eglite. While they're coming up, I would like you to go back to the polling system to select again the A3 room and to say if you agree or disagree with the next statement, which is access to education is more of a priority than the quality of education. So the voting starts now. So this is a bit more different than what we had before. And it's a bit connected to what was said earlier on the indicators and what we would like to have in terms of indicators, either quantitative indicators, meaning how many young people can and children can access to education, or qualitative indicators. So maybe we can come back to that answering the questions. So I would like first to invite Ralph to present his statement and present himself, himself, please.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ralph, and I'm a young delegate representing youth from Latvia. First of all, I want to say that it's a pleasure to be here in Brussels, and I'm glad that I do have this opportunity to speak about our development goals and join the discussion. The main reason why I chose to focus on quality of education topic today is because, first of all, I'm a student myself. Secondly, I do think it's very important for young people, and I also did get inspired by words once said by Nelson Mandela, that education is the most powerful weapon we can use to change the world. And I think each and every one of us can completely agree with that. As a motivated and willing to study student myself, I had a couple of discussions with people my age about how we can improve the quality of education, and we came to a conclusion that the current education system is only partially preparing us for the job market and skills required. Because if your education is not connected with your future profession, then it's just a bag of knowledge, and if you don't use it, it completely loses the value of it. So nowadays, we face attendance, which is also an experience gained when young people are getting their education just to get the grade, but they have a huge problem finding a job. Youth unemployment is a proof of that we do have problems and we have to make improvements in our education system. There are countries where this problem has increased only during the past few years, but we have to take care of this immediately because otherwise we are going to lose a whole generation who are going to search for job opportunities abroad, and they mostly do become low-skilled workers because they don't see the usage of their own knowledge. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the answer for this is lifelong learning, and each and every one of us should be capable of competing not only in their own field, but also be brave enough to retrain for something completely new. I would like to end my speech with another quote. It's not just learning that's important, it's learning what to do with what you learn. And my question is going to be directed to Madam Prime Minister of Latvia, Lendlota Straujuma, and the question goes like this. What has Latvian government done in past few years to better prepare students for the job market? Thank you for your attention.
And now we're moving to Edgars, please.
Hi, my name is Edgars, and I'm 16 years old, Millennium Youth Delegate from Latvia. And I'm glad to be here and speak about sustainable development goals in Europe and development days. And how we know there's 17 development goals and each of one is important, but because we find, if we find a solution for one of them, more or less we solve the problem for each another one. And for me, an important goal is quality education because I'm studying in vocational school in capital of Latvia, Riga. And how we know vocational school is a place where you can study after you end 9th or 12th grade, and after ending it, a vocational school gives you a profession and diploma that you ended this school. But a lot of people think that this diploma doesn't mean that you have a profession, it's like just a sheet of paper where it's written that you ended this school. And subtopic which I was chosen is, does vocational school have so bad reputation that they need to have? Because situation in Latvia, Baltics and some European countries is similar. A government thinks that vocational schools play important role in education, but between young people, there's a bad reputation in vocational schools. Why? Because they think that vocational schools don't have a high education level, and this is made it for stupid people. But it isn't. Education level in vocational schools is high and higher than even in high schools. These opportunities which you have when you end the vocational school is more than you have when you end high school. After you end high school, you don't have a profession, you don't have a lot of work experience, and even it's more difficult to find a job. And I think that together we can change the stereotype and make more students who are studying in vocational school easier finding job and bringing future in them arms. And if youth will have a job, there will be solved a lot of problems in government and the entire world level. And I will end my speech with a question to Mrs. Lemdota Straujma. And how do you think, is it possible to change youth's opinion about vocational school education level and opportunities after ending them? If yes, how?
Thank you very much. Then we're moving to Stephen, please. It should be working, yeah.
Hello. Good morning, fellow panel members, Madame Lemdota, Mr. Akbad, and Ms. McGavin. My name is Stephen Reid. I'm 16 years old, and I am a young delegate from the Republic of Ireland. And like Ms. McGavin, I have the privilege of speaking my first language. I represent the young people of Ireland and the National Youth Council, but I also represent Scouting Ireland, a uniformed, non-formal educational movement. The Republic of Ireland is filled with dedicated young people and other dedicated youth organisations who strive to better themselves and their communities. Especially within Scouting, we are constantly undergoing community, national and international projects, which all relate back to these 17 goals, such as well-being, peace, quality education and safer communities. Yet these organisations are constantly being undervalued and undermined by cut funding and lack of recognition for the work that they do for our communities and the young people in these communities. I personally have spent more than half of my life as a member of multiple youth groups and non-formal education groups, such as Scouting and Youth Theatre. Without them, I would not be here today. They helped me develop my talents and my skills and my confidence, and that put me in this position. We learn for ourselves about development and world issues and the value of hard work, and form our own ideas and opinions and take action. Yet funding for the arts and youth groups is still being cut because it is not seen as valuable by the government. How can we expect young people, not only in Ireland, but all over the world, to get involved in making these goals a reality when projects and organisations which provide the opportunity for young people to learn and get involved are not receiving the recognition that they deserve? My question is for Ms. McGavin. How can you promote the value and support for the non-formal education sector, because it is of vital importance to young people?
Thank you very much. Before going to Marita, I would like to remind you to don't hesitate to use Twitter and to contribute to add some inputs and stuff so that I can keep looking for them and maybe give them to the speakers that we have so that we can continue on the discussion. You can go.
Hello, everyone. My name is Marita, and I'm 20 years old. I represent SOS Children Villages as a member of Latvia. And I will speak about gender equality in the education system. The main point I want to make is that in Latvia, we have two sides when young people choose their profession. There are big gender stereotypes about jobs. And if they aren't choosing the first choice, they're making their life difficult because of society labels. For instance, boys have to become mechanics and girls become nurses. I believe that we need to educate the society about gender equality. For example, in education system, boys and girls from young age are not given a choice to follow what they really want to do. And these gender rules follow through to university and profession life. So my question for Madame Lemdota Straujma
is, how do you plan to educate society about gender equality and to reform the education system so that boys and girls have a choice and they feel free and good about their choice?
So this is quite interesting because we're starting to have some debates around gender equality at national level. So we'll ask you to start.
I am very happy to hear all these three questions because it is these are topics what we are discussing in Latvia. It's now what Ralph asked about quality of higher education, and he comes from Ventspils, where you have university, Ventspils University, and I guess it is not bad university.
It's not bad at all.
But if we speak about reform, what we are thinking for, we have systems that money comes with student. But for next year, we will propose that money will come not only with number of students, but there will be taken in account quality of education in high schools, in universities, and performance. Printing, research reports, and different, there are different criteria how we will evaluate. And what Edgar's asked about professional education, it is as well one of issues what we are discussing, and even we changed legislation about professional education, and we linked professional education with business, with industries, and now we have first professional schools, for example, in city Valmiera, where glass timber enterprise organized in professional school of Valmiera special group, where half of time students will spend in factory and another half in school. So it is topics about what we are discussing very hard, and education is one of the priorities of our government, but really it is not easy topic. We have 2 million people in Latvia, but we have 52 higher education institutions, and here is a question about quality. If in all 52 institutions quality is proper, and maybe we will need consolidation and increase quality of teaching. So we will meet in Latvia. It will be very interesting for me to discuss with you more when you will come in Latvia, because we have youth council, and now in the Ministry of Education youth Council, they work youth development program for Latvia. So young persons, maybe some of you are in this council. I am not so.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I am from youth council of Latvia.
Yeah, you see, then you know. And about equality of gender, do you feel in equality in Latvia yourself?
I mean, in school. It's cool. You can see there are a lot of more female teachers than men.
Yeah. It is. Yeah, it is so. But we have movement possible mission, and now Minister of Education is from that mission, and they collect money from society and from entrepreneurs to educate new school directors, boys, young people, men, because really in Latvia we have this maybe, I don't say that it is a problem, but it is a situation what we have we have more women as teachers than boys, than men. But I can't promise you that we will solve next year this. So it, but yeah, probably it will be benefit to children that there will be more equal percentage, but sorry, I can't promise this. I can't promise this. But anyway, thank you, Latvian young lady and young boys, no, but guys, young guys, for being here. It is really very interesting for me, and I will be happy to meet you in Latvia as well.
Well, we've been discussing about education and gender equality and the job market. And there is one last topic. And maybe on that, I would like to ask you, Ahmed, because I've heard you said before that the youth sector is the most underfunded sector in civil society. So how do you think the post-2015 agenda could be an opportunity to change this situation?
Well, thank you for that. It's evident almost, and I challenge you in this room to think of it. And my argument is this. The least funded group in civil society organizations are youth-led organizations. You will find many organizations working in youth, but not necessarily young people themselves. And as you rightly said, young people usually they are seen as passionate but not professional. They don't know how to manage their money. So let's give them like a few $1,000 here while you give the big money somewhere else. And my argument is simple. If you really want to work with young people, you have to engage them and to trust them with resources. And you have to make the funding as well. And with the chair of the Committee of Development, I think we really have to think together of how to make the fund accessible for young people. It's not always about millions of dollars, but also about making sure that the resources are available and accessible and acceptable as well for youth. And that's something we have to fix. We have a youth sector that is desperately needing resources, and we have basically young people that we are calling them the ones who will be carry the heavy lifting of the post-2015 development agenda. And as we are thinking the financing now, our financing framework, young people, they have to be recognized there. If I can cover the question of education very quickly, I think the question was about access to education and quality education. And let's make no mistake here. Access to education is still a big issue. We still have around 58 million children out of school. We still have 63 million on the age of secondary education, they are out of school. We have around 126 million young persons illiterate. They don't read or write. And we have half of those who are out of school, they're in conflict zones. We have a big challenge there. Even like a country like Syria, they were close to achieve full literacy, and now we have 2 million children in Syria out of school. So it's a disaster. So make no mistake, access to education and to school is still a big issue. But relatively, and I agree with this hypothesis, that relatively it's easier to put the children or a young person in a classroom, and it's much more difficult to ensure that they are learning while they are in the classroom. And we need to fix the education system in a way that is adaptable, that is the 21st century, and we need to think of education system that allow young people to be equipped with the skills and tools and how to think, not what to think. These fixed ideas should be challenged. I'll give you a personal story. My first degree was computer information system. So we studied programming at university. By the time I graduate, my degree was totally outdated. All the things I learned at school. There was a new program languages out in the market and totally different sets. So what you mentioned about lifelong learning is essential. And to do lifelong learning, we really need to change the mentality. We need to have the skills and the capacity to do this lifelong learning, which is quite challenging for many, and to be adaptable. The era when like maybe it used to be this way, that you go to university for 4 years, and then you work for 40 years with that degree that you got at university, that's over. And lifelong learning is the way forward. And the other thing here, when you need to create 600 million jobs, I always say this. All the trainings, when I remember what type of trainings we were getting at school, most of this informal training and informal education training were about how to write a resume, how to write your CV, to seek jobs out there, as if there were jobs to be sought in the first place. I mean, and I don't even remember one training about how to write a business plan, or how to take risk, how to seek funding. If I have an idea, how to operationalize that idea and get it in the market. So I think we also need to graduate job innovators, not only job seekers. We need to create jobs, but also we need to invent jobs. And I think that's part of the shift that we need to push for. But I mean, it's a long conversation if we know an ecosystem that is supportive to young entrepreneurs to grow. So I think education is still, I would say, the backbone for development. That's how the way I describe it. If we to make the post-2015 development a success, education has to be the backbone of that agenda, both for boys and girls, and particularly for young women and girls. I think the challenge there is much more daunting. So we need to fix the access question and simultaneously work in the enhancing the quality of education as well.
Thank you very much. If you don't mind, Mrs. McLagan, we're running a bit late, and I would like to have time to hear the next session, and I know that you will be one of the key speakers for the next session. You have a lot of questions incoming. So maybe I would like to thank the young people here for their inputs and ideas and questions as well. And I will invite to the stage, so Emily Egan, Olga Zozule, Ellen O'Driscoll, and Elgleison Rodriguez. Thank you. While they're coming up on the stage, so to remind you, we had the first session on more or less social inclusion, if we take a broad topic, the second one on education, and the last one will be focusing on well-being of people and the planet. As you all know, there are negotiations, at least if we speak about the well-being of the planet, there are negotiations happening right now, and that will continue until the COP21 happening in Paris, so in Europe, which is a big thing. I would like to ask you one question. So what do you think of the statement? Keeping in mind the topic that we will discuss now. The sentence is this one: we must primarily rely on citizen participation and civil society actors to bring positive change for the well-being of people and the planet. So the voting starts now. Do you agree or not? So this is quite interesting. We're starting to have some kind of division in the room. So if you see where we're going with this question is basically questioning the role of institutions at all level, and how can actors, different actors, bring contribute to the challenges that we are facing right now. So this will be quite interesting for the different representatives that we have here and the different levels that they represent to maybe say a bit of that. Before that, I would like to start with Emily. You can start, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Emily Egan. I'm 16 years old and I'm from Ireland. I'm a young delegate and today I'll be speaking about mental health. The reason I feel so strongly about this topic is because in Ireland there's a very high suicide rate. For young boys, it's the second in Europe and girls is the first in Europe. Considering the size of Ireland, this fact shocked me and made me want to raise awareness to prevent more occurrences like this. To reduce the rate of suicide, we need to remove the stigma attached to mental health. At the moment, mental health is considered mental illness, but that is not the case. Mental health is a state of well-being that needs to be looked after just the same as physical health. Within society, people are pressured to look, think, and act a certain way. When people don't conform to these expectations, they feel like outsiders. With my youth group in Ireland, we have been working with our peers to help understand what makes a healthy mind. For example, we promote 5 little steps that, if done, will take care of your mind. In fact, all of us know that in order to keep our body healthy, we need to go to the gym and eat well. So, we need to spread the message on how to keep your mind in good shape. We need to find interesting ways to spread the message to young people. We need not only the support of our government, but also the European Union. So my question is to Mrs. McGavin, is what could the European Union do to help promote mental health and break the stigma? Thank you.
Thank you very much. So this is quite interesting to see this topic connecting with the previous one we had on education, but also in terms of social inclusion, because if we think about all the young people that are at risk because they don't have an employment or they're out of education, they are the ones that need as well to be in this kind of process for them to be helped in terms of mental health and not to be at risk more globally, and not only in terms of education and employment, but all of this is connected. So this is quite interesting as well. Thank you, Emily. I would go to Olga, please.
Good morning, dear ladies and gentlemen. My name is Olga. I'm 17 years old. I represent youth from Latvia. Today, I would like to speak about peace. To reach this goal, every country should provide safety and confidence to their population. Thus, we will live in a peaceful and united world where everyone is protected. Because each human is a part, and all parts together create a unit which is called our world. We should all together make a progress in peace, love, and unity. I think it's the best way forward for humanity. But today I will focus on Latvian youth opinions about this topic. When I was preparing for European Development Days, I have made a little research in my school. I have asked 50 teenagers one question. The question was, what global issues are the most important for you? About 70% of teenagers answered that they have a fear of the Third World War. So young people, not only in Latvia, are really afraid of their lives, because nowadays in many countries are going worse. I would like to ask Envoy Foyas, Mr. Ahmed Al-Hindawi, how this problem can be solved and how to ensure young people that they will live in peace and safety. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. And then we will go to Ellen, please.
Ladies and gentlemen and honored guests, my name is Eleanor Driscoll, I'm 16 years old, and I'm a Millennium Youth Delegate from the Republic of Ireland. The topic I've chosen to speak to you about today is climate change. I believe that climate change is one of the biggest difficulties that we as human beings face. I believe it is so difficult because it is so hard to change public opinion and people's views. This has such a big impact on us and our Earth. This Earth is our future. It is not a renewable source, and we are quickly destroying it. Many people do not believe that climate change is a real thing, but the truth is that it is a very real and very current issue. The rise in global temperatures has led to horrific effects through tropical storms. Although these effects are felt stronger in the developing world, I feel that as countries and citizens of this world, it is still our job to help do what we can to prevent the loss of lives. I know that changing public opinion and people's views is not easy, and it will not be done overnight, but I think that if we all did little things, and it's a long journey, but if we all work together, it would make it so much easier and our efforts would be worthwhile. Doing small things for the planet, such as recycling or saving electricity, when we all... It speeds up the journey when we all put in a helping hand, and it can really make a difference, although it may not seem like it in the short run. As a As was once said, the longest journey starts with the smallest step. And I believe that raising awareness on this topic and how the future of our Earth relies on it and taking action to battle climate change will not only save our lives, but those of generations to come. I think that including awareness of climate change within our education system from an early stage will benefit us all. This would help open youth's eyes to the fact that our world is the only planet to, as far as my knowledge goes, that is able to sustain us. And by destroying it, you are in turn destroying yourselves and future generations. My question is for Mrs. McCavan. What I want to know is how we can include awareness about climate change within schools and our education, especially from an early age, so that they will be aware of what dangers and on what we can do to prevent it. Also, how can we make our message effective so that they do not forget and it will resound within them? So when they are making future choices in their lives, that hopefully their conscience will speak out, as it has done for me during, because I've been benefited from learning about it in school. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I would like us to finish and go back to Eglison Rodriguez, who is a future leader and from Brazil, so it can bring a different approach a bit. Thank you.
Buenos dias a todos. Mi nombre es Eglison Rodriguez, soy de Brasil, tengo 22 años. Estoy aquí representando a mis amigos del Movimiento Nacional Jóvenes Monitoreando as Políticas Públicas.
Hello, yeah. So his name is Eglison Rodriguez. He's 22 years old and he comes from Brazil. And he represents a youth movement. It's called Youth Monitoring Public Policy.
Muchas veces nosotros decimos que la juventud es el futuro del país, la juventud es nuestro futuro, pero muchas veces y en todo el mundo y principalmente en Latinoamérica y Brasil, la juventud no está teniendo derecho de llegar al futuro.
Often said that youth is the future of the country, the youth is the future of the world, but actually in Brazil it's not the case. Youth do not really have a lot of rights.
Entonces, nosotros contra movimiento de juventud tenemos que estar involucrados en los procesos de cambio para que los derechos de niños, adolescentes y jóvenes puedan ser garantizados. El derecho a la educación, el derecho a la salud, el derecho a los servicios principales para que tú puedas tener una buena vida.
He and his movement, the youth movement, they are working towards an advancement of the right of education, health and basic needs for young people in Brazil.
Entonces, la juventud tiene que estar involucrada en el proceso de toma de decisiones, tiene que estar siendo parte de los discursos, tiene que tener una participación política en los procesos de sus comunidades para que podamos juntos cambiarmos las realidades de niños, niñas, y así podemos garantizar el bienestar para los todos.
He advocates for the youth that takes part in the decision making in politics in Brazil, and that all communities, that all boys and girls from all communities have a good being, all the basic needs covered.
Entonces, es muy importante que la juventud esté diciendo lo que quieres. Que lo que tenemos que estar involucrado en las tomas de decisiones para que los medios, para que los procesos que el gobierno va a tomar, las decisiones que el gobierno va a tomar, la juventud esté representada en ellos.
So, he wants the youth to be represented and to take part into the decision-making and decision-making processes in general.
Por isso, em Brasil, nós estamos fazendo parte de uma mobilização contra a morte da juventude. Então, minha pergunta é para o Mr. Hamad, o que as Nações Unidas está fazendo para evitar, para lutar contra a morte da juventude por armas de fogo?
So his movement has taken part in, like, it's part of a mobilization against youth mortality. So they want to reduce the youth mortality rates. And his question is for Mr. Hamad Al-Ndawi. So his question is, what is the UN doing in order to reduce the youth mortality rate because of fire, guns or arms?
Porque creemos que la juventud tiene derecho a vida y ese derecho tiene que ser respetado por todos.
Because he believes youth has the right to live, and since in Brazil there is a really high rate of mortality because of suicide, so yeah, he thinks it's very important.
Obrigado. Gracias. Thank you.
Thank you. So it's quite interesting because we are a bit coming back from a different way to health and well-being of young people. We're also mentioning a bit of young people's participation, and maybe one thing to connect with the topic of climate change, since we have the negotiation ongoing right now, to maybe see what are the differences in terms of young people participation when we consider the development goals, the SDGs, and the process in terms of sustainable development and climate change, to see how it's involving or not young people and what can be done there. So maybe we could start with Mrs. McAvan. Please, the floor is yours.
Yes, and thank you. Maybe just, I didn't get to answer Stephen's question in the last round, just to say to him, he talked about cultural funding and cutbacks in funding. Just to say to you that I think all governments should be aware that there are different kinds of wealth in society. There's social capital as well as real money capital, and societies are better, more stable when they invest in all kinds of aspects of society. So we need to invest in organizations, cultural organizations, youth organizations. That makes for a stronger society and also a more innovative society. And so, yes, I know in my country we have enormous cutbacks in all public funding, but we have to fight to make sure our own government makes sure the funding is available for youth organizations and for other kinds of voluntary organizations. Emily asked about mental health and what the EU is going to do. I'm now the chair of the Committee on International Development, but in the previous parliament, I was very involved in the Committee on Health, Public Health, and we did have an awareness raising about mental health issues, because in most countries, mental health has not been funded at the same level as what we think of normal health. Well, that's not the right word, but health, other health issues. And in fact, it's one of the biggest reasons why people don't go to work in mental health. It's one of the huge, and so it's a loss to society, but also, as you said, very seriously can lead to suicide. And although the EU itself does not fund health systems are funded by national governments. In fact, we have a big debate now about what Europe should do, what Europe shouldn't do, and most people say there's a thing called subsidiarity, that something should be done at home. So health systems are funded through your national governments, not through the European Union, and that's not going to change. So I think, again, it's about raising awareness about the problems of mental health and making sure they're treated on the same level as other health issues and seen as something that the state should fund. And it's very sad to hear about the levels of suicide in Ireland. I wonder if they've got worse since the economic problems. That would be interesting to know, whether there's a correlation between increased suicide and economic problems, lack of jobs, lack of opportunity. And then I'll leave Olga's question about for mainly about peace and that's a question for the our Latvian Prime Minister, but only to say that. You know, the European Union is a good example of how we made peace. We the EU, the European Union countries, they're the bloodiest continent the world has ever known, Europe. We have slaughtered each other and murdered each other on the battlefields of Europe since time began, and we only learned after the last war in 1945 that this was not the way. And since we stopped fighting each other, we created better societies for the people we live in. I understand if I was with all the problems on your borders in the East with Russia, I understand why people might feel nervous now, but we have to fight for peace. We have to maintain the peace. Peace is always better than war. We should have, as Churchill said after the war, Winston Churchill, jaw, 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 not war, 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 jaw, 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 I mean talking. We have to talk and negotiate and find peace. Absolutely vital. Climate change, Eleanor, absolutely right. Climate change is an enormous problem. I think we have to destroy the idea that there's a scientific debate about climate change. There is not a scientific debate about climate change. Scientists, 99.9% of scientists are clear, climate change exists. And the people who are saying there isn't climate change are mainly funded by people with a vested interest to be against climate change, by big corporations who make their money out of fossil fuels. And so that's why there's nervousness of teaching about climate change in schools, when it should be taught like any other science issue. It's a science, there's a global warming happening, and there's a scientific consensus that is happening. So I agree with you that we should do more about schools, but we also have to have a public debate. And to your question, whose responsibility? For Paris, the responsibility clearly is with governments, with the EU. Political leaders now have to take the right decisions. They have to make the decisions for the long term and be brave and do it. Otherwise, it's too late. We will be looking, the future, your generation will not thank us if we do not take our responsibilities. But you have to help us take our responsibilities by creating the climate for politicians to take decisions. You have to push them, lobby them, write to them, make them take the right decisions. And that is the responsibility of citizens as well. Because if the only vocal people are the people who don't like wind farms, who don't like wind energy, then that's that the politicians listen to them. So the people who want change and want a deal in Paris on climate have to speak out publicly as well and make their voice heard. So I'm very pleased, Eleanor, that you're doing that and you're making your voice heard here on climate change. And on the last point about, I won't answer because other people can, you're right that we need to hear the voices. Your voice has to be heard. And youth organizer. I used to work for the Youth Forum when I was younger. I was a press officer for the European Youth Forum. So, quite a while ago now. And I know the importance of youth organizations and young people speaking out. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, so I would ask Ahmed and Madam Prime Minister to have some short inputs because we're already running late. And I would like to be able to have some kind of wrap-up session in the end. So maybe, Madam Prime Minister, you can start.
Yeah. I was very surprised when I saw your voting to participate or not participate. It was 40-40. It was really... I can't understand. Why are you are here if you don't want to participate? You have to participate in taking decisions. All, each of you. Therefore, it was very, very, we discussed a little bit, it was very, very unbelievable for me. But in the end, I really have to leave you because I have to go to another session, but it was very inspiring for me to be with young people here, and I am happy that here are so many young persons from Latvia. I want to repeat two main keywords: education, all-level education, and participation. You have to participate, and again, Olga, Ralph, Edgars, everybody has to participate. Has to be in different possibilities. We have in Latvia council memorandum of understanding where it was signed from all organizations what we have in Latvia. And every month this council meets as government, and it is, I think, it's a real way how to tell what and how government has to behave or what kind of decisions have to be taken if you will or young people and not so young people will be silent, then how government will know what happens in the field? Therefore, I ask all of you, please participate, and all together we can change our planet, our world for next generations. And thank you for being here to everybody. And sorry, I'm leaving you now. Okay. And see you in Latvia. I invite you in Latvia, all of you.
And then, so I will let you answer the question of the young people. And then maybe just while you will say what you are taking home from this session and maybe what you can commit to do to ensure youth participation in terms of what's coming next. So in terms of the implementation and the follow-up evaluation process of the SDGs. And I will ask you as well the same question in the end. While you answer, if some of you that are active on Twitter can answer as well this question, and this can appear on the Twitter wall, this could be good. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I think the question of was directed to me is around peace and security, or the question related to situation of young people, which also your question comes under that same debate. That's to say, the question of peace and security of the young people is a question of a great concern to me personally, and my mandate as Secretary General of Foreign Youth, I prioritize the plight and the situation of young people in conflict zones, but not only in conflict zones, even in places where there are high crime rates. Our estimates that 600 million young people, they live in a situation, either fragile security situation or conflict zones, and we know all the troubles and problems facing young people in these countries. Last month, we had for the first time the Security Council debate and the question of youth, the broader debate around peace building. Later this year, in 2 months, we'll have a global forum on youth peace and security, and which will offer for the first time a chance for youth organization working in this sector to come together and come up with the one unified, I would say, vision for how they would like to take this agenda forward. So that's to say that it's high in my agenda, it's high in the United Nations priorities, and I think this year is also significant. What we learned from the MDGs, peace, security is the foundation for development. If there's one of the correlations we learned from the MDGs is whenever you have a conflict, it's very difficult to do development. Almost all countries affected by conflict will not be able to achieve even one of the 8 MDGs, and that's a clear correlation that we need to break, basically, in the next development agenda. And I think that's to say that young people are also peace builders. They are not the troublemakers, because that's also we need to challenge the narrative. Sometimes in the growing talk about all this radicalization, we tend easily to label young people as the problem. This society has so many problems because they have so many young people, and that's just wrong. When we counter even violent extremism, we have also to counter the negative narrative about young people, and I think that's something we need to do much more at that front. With the climate change, and before climate change, maybe just to say something about mental health. I think you received a very good answer from the chair of the development committee. But to add, last year the United Nations marked the International Youth Day with highlighting the question of youth and mental health. And you might be surprised to know that 1 out of 5 young people, they have some mental health issues. So this is not happening at the corner. It's a big issue. Almost 20% of young people they struggle with that, and we need to elevate this issue and to talk more about it, and also to add it to our understanding of the health, and to add it more investments at the national level there. To add to conclude with the climate change, I think young people can do mean significant contribution to the negotiation this year by demanding bold actions and commitment to be made at the climate summit end of this year in Paris. For me, young people, they are innovators, consumers, and voters. as voters, they can drive governments out of office if they are not favoring climate actions. And as the consumers, they can drive businesses out of market if they are not becoming more sustainable. And as innovators, they can help us to mitigate and also to put the planet in a sustainable path. As clearly this year is announced as the year for people and the planet. And as the Secretary of Ban Ki-moon always says, that we might be the last generation that could reverse the climate change, but the first generation that could and extreme poverty. And with this, it's a great mandate for all of us to be the generation who could really do this two great things. And you asked me what I'm going to take back with me to New York. Obviously, I'll take back my jet lag. I still have it, so I'll bring it back with me. So, but also, I will continue to work hard from there for all these voices, all the messages we received today, which I think they articulate a very good youth agenda, from supporting youth organizations, talk about empowerment, education, employment for young people, peace and security, the question of health in general, but also mental health, empowerment of women. All these questions, I think the sum of our discussion today could easily put a roadmap for youth empowerment and youth development. And that's just for me, another reminder that not one issue that we need to take when we talk about young people, it has to be a holistic approach. Thank you very much for highlighting that.
Thank you very much. And then I would ask Madam McEwen to say as well what she will bring back home, and maybe in the European Parliament as well, about those topics that were raised today by the young people.
I think what I heard is expectations are high, that people are looking now for a better future. And that's what the big meeting in New York in September is really about. It's about, do we make the choice to work together as nations to create a better world where the sort of things you're talking about, the peace, job, decent work for people, tackling poverty, are done? Or do we go back home and start getting suspicious of each other and fighting and wasting human energy and actually wasting lives in conflict and in those kind of issues? So I want to that we meet in September. We don't just have warm words. After the warm words, we have some action points. We monitor. There's somebody earlier, we asked about monitoring. We have to have things to monitor. And that, and maybe to say to World Vision and the other organizers today, maybe they should come back to these young people in 5, in 10 years and see what happened to their lives. And did we deliver? And maybe you should ask them, you know, to keep in touch. Because that's the judge. You'll be the judge. If in 15 years' time nothing has changed and we're still having the same debates, that will be a failure. And in a way, I don't think the world can afford to have that failure. So we have to act as well as talk as well in September.
Thank you very much. Okay, so we'll make sure that everyone keeps in touch on those topics. I would like to thank again everyone that could contribute, the young people, but as well as the panelists that were invited. Thank you very much for your contribution. We did not have time to see the tweets, but I'm sure you saw them as long as the discussion were going. I think you can find again, this session will be online. There will be some information on the website of the partner organizations. So thanks for joining again. We will leave the room for next session. And just last information, technical information, don't forget to hand out the headphones. Thank you very much.